Here's one of the groups that really believed in this event, as we believe in them, Triumph.
Live rock and roll should be big and great and fantastic.
That's the element of rock and roll that keeps adolescent youth so gonzo about it.
That gathering of 14,000 people in a hockey rink is the epitome of what we do.
These guys are from Toronto, and they're blowing up.
Triumph. Triumph.
In the early 80s, Triumph were as big as Van Halen. They were as big as Motley Crue.
Triumph has never played.
As a rock fan, bands disappoint you, and Triumph never did that.
They were the good guys in an era that was meant for the dirtbags.
I was like, how are these guys not as big as Led Zeppelin? And then all of a sudden, that's it.
I broke their hearts, I know I did. There was a lot of guilt.
The fallout from that was horrible.
We went into a dark place for years.
With Triumph breaking up decades and decades ago, we were left missing something.
We hadn't played in a long time, but we'll see.
We've always felt this huge debt to our fans.
This is about the three of us having an integrity and closing a chapter for the band.
Won these at the fair?
Oh, that's my old shirt, man.
I think I had the coolest one, though.
Well, let's start making them and see if we can sell them.
So bootleg their merch.
Yep.
And make some money.
Hey there.
Adam?
Hi, Mike.
How are you?
All right, how are you, sir?
Good, good.
It's nice to meet you.
Good to meet you, too. Yep. Whereabouts are you located, Adam?
I am in, I'm a lifelong New Yorker, meaning New York City, but I moved, unlike all those others who fled the city in the last year and a half or so. I would have fled the country, but it was going to be a lot harder to do that. I was on the phone last night with one of my best friends. He's my best friend, and he's from Toronto, so he's, you know, and I was telling him all about today, and I was going to meet you, and I was going to meet Gillen a little later today. So I was getting very geared up and excited to tell him about it and ask him about his own, you know, thoughts and memories of Triumph.
All right.
Do
you have any?
Quite a few. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, totally. I think everybody has nothing but positive. Positive feelings about the band. If anything, I don't think it was very controversial. You know what I mean? It was kind of at the time, right? It wasn't like a controversial band, was it?
Not really. You know, we were.
Yeah.
The only controversy was,
You made a very commercial band, it turns out, with really great songs, memorable songs, power pop, kind of crunchy songs. And you guys just sort of were able to achieve this great, legacy of music. So it's got to be wild for you 50 years later to be now the subject of this documentary.
That's true. Gil's coming on this call now, right? He's supposed to be on?
No, I don't think. I think it's just you and me, kid.
No, he's supposed to be on this call.
Oh, I apologize if that's the case. I was under the, I think, we're going to not know for sure, because I think I had just confirmed that I was doing a separate one with him at 6. It would be great.
Oh, when did you confirm that?
Well, you know Hadley, right, of course.
Yeah,
just a few minutes ago.
All right, yeah, because I talked to Gil this morning. We did another one together this morning, and I said, I'll see you at 11:30.
I would love to have done all three. You know, it's fine. I mean, all three of you guys, but I'm happy to talk to you individually, together, separate, doesn't matter, right. You know. But let's do.
Okay, sorry. Let's pick up that. Sorry about that.
Not at all. Don't worry about it. Please. I'm glad to, as I said, just do these. I'm going to put them together anyway. So,
right.
You know,
but get at all my bad stuff. Huh?
Let's not bury the lead though. This documentary is long in the waiting for Triumph fans, super fans and others. And it's called Triumph Rock and Roll Machine, which is one of your hits. Refers to one of your hits, I should say. And it will have its world premiere at the Toronto International Film Festival, TIFF, on this Friday, the 10th. I'm sorry, not correct. The
it's past the premiere now.
It already had its world premiere, and now I'm looking at it. So is it having more? Let me rephrase then. So I don't.
Okay. Cut.
Take two. Thank you, man. You're hired. How did the world premiere go, by the way?
It was, you know, it was kind of cool. You know, we had, you know, we got prime real estate at the, because, you know, as you know, TIFF, you know, they're down to four theaters at half yeah. Capacity and three drive-ins.
Right.
And so
and you
we
did
took
it at the RBC Lakeside. Yeah.
Yeah, the RBC one, which is good, 180 and 190 cars or something, which is sizable. And no COVID restrictions, really, unless you went to the concessions or went to the bathroom. That was it. So no matter what, you couldn't be canceled. You didn't have to show proof of vaxes. You didn't have to go get a daily test. You didn't have all those kinds of potential restrictions
going on.
So we went for that. We thought, you know, the average Triumph fan probably has a car. It might be an old car, but they're going to have a car. Or a brand new BMW, who knows? But you know, right. Sold out, and it was you know, fantastic. But we had a like an industry style party simultaneously behind the drive-in at a club that Live Nation has there.
Okay.
And, you know, it was a beautiful place, and we loaded in like I think about 20 big screens. Put in a sound system all around the club, so every screen had a sound along, the good sound along with it. And so we introduced the film at the drive-in, jumped back on a golf cart or I think we were in somebody's Tesla or something. Anyway, and it was like a 2-minute drive back to the club. So as soon as we got there, they ran the film.
And the club where is the, by the way, where the RBC, I'm going to guess it's on Lake Ontario. Is it by the beaches? Is that what it's called?
No, it's at a place called Ontario Place, which is close by the Canadian National Exhibition. It's just across the water, so to speak. Not very far. There's a bridge you can walk across.
So, but folks are watching from like with a lake behind, sort of right there. So it's kind of cool.
Yeah, it's really a beautiful, beautiful spot. We did some TV stuff at the club because the club is half indoors, half outdoors.
Right.
And so we did some great outdoor stuff that, you know, had this cityscape behind it.
Uh-huh.
And, you know, so it was just fabulous. I think that runs on the big Canadian show E-Talk.
Did you guys get a chance to do a set?
No.
Oh, wow. That's,
it would have been way too complicated.
So what? When has that stopped any of you guys?
But in the film we played.
Well, yes. And I know, and I guess we can, is it a spoiler to mention the super fan event at the end? Is it?
No, what, I that don't
you,
think so.
You know, because we kind of it was certainly a surprise. I'm referring to this reunion you guys had, the three of you, playing for what appears to be, I mean, for all I know, you played before, but in the film, it appears like you haven't played together publicly in front of in some time.
Yeah, since 2008 would have been the last time. So we're dealing 2008 to 2019.
Right.
So that's fair. And maybe you're right about the spoiler part now that I think about it.
No, we can leave it out. So you got to see the documentary.
Because it's an incredible moment. And
it is.
As good as it looks on the film, it's not half as good as it was to be there in real life.
Yeah.
Honestly, it was just mind-boggling what happened.
Right. And I liked it. I liked the, by the way, the directors are... Sam Dunn and Mark Ricciardelli. Did I
Ricciardelli is better. Ricciardelli? We've been calling him Mark Ricciardelli for the last
Ricciardelli.
I finally asked him before we introduced the film at the drive-in.
Yeah.
I asked him, have we been pronouncing your name right for all these years? He goes, no.
Forget it.
Well, how do you say it? He says, Ricciardelli.
Oh, Ricciardelli, yeah. I have a friend who I just brought on. His name is Carmine Famiglietti. So it has a talk about music, those Italian, wonderful Italian names. I mean, us Jewish boys, we have pretty straightforward names. Although, correct. I guess mine is a little bit more European than Levine, but half my family, by the way, are Levines.
Oh, really? Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Down here, yeah. And they were all in New Jersey or wherever, but yeah. Yeah. I have no doubt that this documentary, which again is called Triumph, Rock and Roll Machine, is going to have some great success. People love these types of, you guys, I mean, I think the big message that comes through is that the sense of brotherhood and bonds that you guys have, and no matter how tested they are, at the end of the day, it's strong, really strong.
Yeah, it was one of the things that I think all three of us, because there was that period where we didn't speak, which went on way too long.
As happens to brothers.
Yeah, it's true.
Biological brothers.
With sisters like I got.
That's another documentary, Mike.
But I think, we all wanted to, I would hate to leave this world knowing that the three of us weren't the three musketeers again, kind of, as we talked about ourselves, And I'm really glad, ecstatic, whether we ever played or not, it didn't really matter. It was the fact we were friends again. And that's
beautiful. That comes across too. I mean, I think very authentically in the film, like that, that's what's really, I forget exactly who said it, but I think might've been Rick.
I think it was Rick. Yeah.
Who talked about the cause I think he felt like maybe he had was walking around with the most guilt. Within the framework of the documentary, I don't, you know exactly how it works in the other version of the non-camera real life, but or not film, non-filmed real life. But do you feel like the film kind of got the sense of the dynamic and of the story of what you guys went through?
Yeah, I think so. Like, I love Sam was really the motivator.
Okay.
And Mark, I mean, he co-directed, but he did the editing. I think
that's
marvelous.
Right. Yeah.
So it helps to have a director / editor involved because he's looking for shots that he knows he's going to use to edit with. It's not,
Of course. Well, yeah, editing is happening during the shooting. I mean, it's when you're just taking hours and hours, countless hours of footage that, and then, of course, there's lots of archive too, which is, I'm sure there was a separate team for that, but possibly, I don't know. Because there's must be so much archive of you guys.
Yeah, well, all our stuff was stored at the University of Toronto. We did this massive donation where we sent two semis full of stuff.
Yeah,
it
right.
was all cataloged. And we have our own archive at the U of T. And so they went down, not just Mark, but Mark spent a lot of time there, excuse me, but other people from Banner Films were down there too, and grabbing stuff and signing it out. And we'd always get a call from the university people say, is it okay that Banger could take this out? It's okay with you guys.
Right.
We kind of knew what was coming.
Is there any point in doing, are you even going to other festivals with this documentary? I mean, you already probably have everything.
Sorry, let's cut there for a sec. Somebody's, my answering machine's turned up way too loud here.
No problem, Mike.
Sorry about that.
Not at all.
a good edit point anyway.
Yeah, no problem. That it's our world. Your home, yeah. Obviously, or you're at your office, one or the other.
No, I'm at home, but I have too many phones, too many lines.
And it's a busy time.
Yeah,
I was asking about like, is this going to be in other festivals? Do you know?
Well, we got it. I think yesterday, the day before, we got an invite from the Philadelphia International Film Festival, Toronto.
Okay, that's a good.
And I don't know if that's a good one or a bad one. You know, film's not really my business, but
I know. No. Philadelphia has a good reputation. It has a good. Yeah. I mean, I wouldn't call it PIFF because it just sounds like. I'll call it TIFF. It's just not a good name. TIFF works, but not PIFF, you know. Just
yeah.
So, and I guess let me. I can't. I don't know. Is this like? Do you guys have? You must be being asked this, but do you guys have plans for more after the documentary? More collaboration in any form?
You know, plans are weird things these days because
it's true.
You know, what you plan today sometimes gets put off till tomorrow and maybe the next day.
Yeah. Well, but, you know the expression, Mike. We make plans and God laughs.
I haven't heard that one, but it's true. We used to have when Gil and I would get together and when Triumph was very, very busy, we have three piles of stuff. You know, stuff that had to get done today, stuff that had to get done tomorrow, and things that could wait forever. And the things that wait forever was 4 feet high, you know? You just go, deal with that later, deal with that later. Just deal with what's right in front of you now. So to that end, the film is right in front of us now. And although I'm not sure when it's going to be commercially released, I think there's going to be some theatrical plays kind of tie in with radio, maybe Cineplex theaters, and some live satellite stuff that, you know, that we can take questions from a theater in New York or that kind of thing.
We're hoping
to put that together. And then it's a question of which streamer, because this all happened so quickly. Like the film got finished and submitted to TIFF.
Right. Well, it was going to happen. It was going to be a TIFF. There was no doubt about it.
Well, we were hoping, you know, but like you never know. They're pretty tough sometimes.
It's true, but they pulled it off. You got a great story here, and it's where it belongs, right?
Yeah. They truly love the film. They didn't do it just because we're a Toronto band. No, that's not why. You know, and I know for a fact.
It's a Toronto story, though, which is always helpful.
It is helpful, for sure. But, you know, we were a little nervous that we would, because, you know, they're down from 400 films to 100 films, right? So, you know, everybody was getting chopped along the way, I suppose.
Yeah, right. Well, I'm glad it did have its world premiere there, and I'm sure the film will have a great trajectory. And I think there'll be undoubtedly a lot of loud insistence of you guys doing some more performing. So anyway, I'm just predicting the future.
Well, that's been the story for the last 10 years. So when are you guys going to play again? We never know. Maybe yes, maybe no. Because you really don't know. Right? Something could come up and we'll go, hey, let's go do five songs. Or, you know, it's like, this will be an easy one. We don't need a big production. We don't need to deal with a lot of different things. Right?
Yeah. So, well, the good news is, it seems like, you know, that age seems not to be so much of an issue anymore in terms of what people want to see. And people realize that, you know, the spirit of rock and roll is timeless. It is ageless. It's not a number. Age is just a number, but rock and roll is not.
Yeah. You know, it's incredibly mind blowing. Like, we just put out a box set of the Allied Forces record. Mm-hmm. For its 40th anniversary. And I go, like, we did that record 40 years ago. And they're still in the box set. We did it for Record Store Day worldwide. And it was a limited edition, so it wasn't like a ton of units, but, you know, it's gone in a heartbeat. You know, it's gone.
Yeah.
And, you know, it still blows my mind that, you know, you can carry on, you know, right through with us doing absolutely virtually nothing, you know, but you turn on a radio in just about any city, you're going to hear a Triumph song, you know, at some point during the day.
Yeah.
And that to me is like amazing.
You grew up in Toronto, right? Did you grow up in, as a kid, when you were starting to play the drums, what were you thinking?
Well, I wasn't playing drums, but I just played piano.
Play keyboards too, right? Right. Right. Yeah. You adopted the drums.
Oh, as I adopted the bass.
Out of necessity. The bass. Bass, excuse me.
Yeah.
Sorry about that. Let me rephrase. So you were started as a keyboard player, though.
Yeah, I studied piano as a kid. Yeah.
Okay.
You know, it's like my dad was a musician, played in the Toronto Symphony Orchestra, was also like the number one call jazz bassist in Toronto when Stan Kenton came through, or Eddie of the Buddy Rich, you know, so he worked his ass off. And I watched him and I was like, there's no way I want to be a musician. Because it's a tough, tough, tough gig.
Yeah.
But then, you know, high school started and, you know, we started a little band and I played guitar along with five other guys and the drummer and a piano organ player. And, you know, we played in high school assemblies, but we found, oh, this is neat because the girls were, you know, we got girls because we're a band.
Of course. Yeah. I mean, that explains the majority of musicians why they get into bands. There is always a shortage of bass players, though. Always. Like a great bass player is a really, you know, valuable commodity because, right? There aren't as many people who choose the bass.
Well, yeah,
it's one of the harder instruments to play on your own.
That's the issue, right? It's like, you know, in the old days, in the folk days, you wouldn't go to a marshmallow roast and sing Bob Pete Seeger songs with a bass player.
Yeah.
Had to be on guitar. So bass is a very lowly instrument. So I admire guys like Eddie Lee and Billy Sheehan, Jaco Pastorius and Richard Davis and Chuck Rady, all the great bass players, Duck Dunn,
Mike
all those
Levine.
Great players, you know, right. Like I can't hold a can with any of those guys. But as my dad once told me, he says, as a bass player, he said, I'm going to tell you one thing, because we couldn't get lessons, were not on the cards. We couldn't get a lot of them. We did one lesson, forgot about it. But he said, just remember one thing. It's not what you play. It's what you don't play that makes
it's what you don't play what?
That makes a difference.
Oh, explain what that means.
Well, a busy bass player eats up the space for everybody else. Your job as a bass player, you work with the drums and, you know, you're the foundation. You're not the feature. So that, when you get...
Yeah,
you
know, that requires a certain personality, right? Like maybe Bill Wyman, somebody like that had that, didn't seem to mind being right. The back.
Roger Glover. Right. Purple, you know, the most underrated bass player, you know, John Entwistle again, you know, in The Who. He wasn't a busy guy. He wasn't a busy player. Noel Redding and Hendrix, he wasn't really a busy player. You know, John Paul Jones and Zeppelin, probably the most underrated bass player ever in the history of music.
Wow.
Amazing bass player, but not busy, you know, just tasty.
Tasty. So you mentioned Jaco Pastorius, and I'm sorry, I didn't expect to get like on this particular thread of conversation, but it seemed like he was like the act. I mean, he definitely supported obviously many musicians as a bass player, but he also did have his own. He was a rare case of a fronting musician as well.
Yeah.
In a short time.
And he could play anything, you know, he could play jazz, he could play rock, he could, you know, you name it. It's like he had one of the, I don't know, I just call it, the magic, the ability to think, you know what you're going to play 8 bars ahead of where you are right now. You already know what's going to happen then, and you're always 8 bars ahead of yourself. And, you know, very few musicians ever have that, ever, you know. So a guitarist named Lenny Bro had that. He was just an amazing guy, an amazing player, died way too young. But, you know, Charlie Parker, again, you know, he he knew where he was going, like before the song started, probably. He knew where he was going to go. But you could probably count on, maybe a few people's hands and feet how many players in the history of music have that.
Thank you for, humoring me and talking to me about music. And it was a real treat to get to do that with you and to talk to you. And I just wish you a tremendous amount of luck with the documentary. And I want lots of people to see it. It was so entertaining. So, for an American, when I say American, not the North American, but in the United States American.
Be very careful now.
These are Americans, right? it was a treat to get to really see, the story unfolding on a band that I was not as familiar with being down here, So it was a real treat, and I was really looking forward to talking to you. So,
well, great. I appreciate that.
Me too. Thank you. All right. Well, all right. So let's bring on Gil Moore now.
Hey, Gil.
Good acting. I have to wait six hours till then.
Don't run tape. No.
And then it's going to be a lot longer till I get Rick on, but that's okay.
Yeah. Well, don't worry. You'll get Gil. It's like he's a machine. Although I think he may have something after you tonight. I can't remember. So
I'm sure. I'm sure. It's got to be a very busy time for you guys.
Yeah. All right, super duper. All right, man. I'm glad you love the film. That's great. And hope to talk to you again soon.
Thank you. Me too.
Okay.
All right. Ciao. Take care. Bye-bye.